The gentleman I'm about to welcome onto the stage has been a very long time supporter of AppDynamics. I joined AppDynamics before there was an AppDynamics UK, 4.5 years ago, when the best they could offer me was a beanbag in the corner of some Regis office or, you know, a corner of a Starbucks. And, you know, you can't really build a company to this sort of size and scale without the support of people like Phil, and Phil has been a huge long-time believer in AppDynamics. So I not only want to thank him for championing us in his various roles and various companies, but also taking his time out of his day to come and share his story around, you know, becoming a world-class CIO. And so please, again, be prepared with some questions at the end, and I hope you enjoy the session. Thank you, Phil. Welcome to you to the stage.
Hi, guys. Sorry I'm late. I work out. Here we go. And I walk in. Get those knees up. This is what I see. Looking good.
I'm sexy and I know it. Woo! I'm sexy and I know it.
Kick! Get those legs up!
Check it out. Wiggle, 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 yeah. Wiggle, 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 yeah. Wiggle, 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 wiggle.
Well, good afternoon. If you're from the UK or Northern European country, you'll recognize that advert. Anybody else haven't got a clue what's going on? I'm the group CIO, global CIO from Specsavers. And I'm going to share with you for the next 30 minutes or so a little bit about the journey of being a CIO and a little bit about my own experiences across a number of organizations. For me, I've worked for 18 companies as a CIO in the last 35 years, mainly the FTSE 100 or the Fortune 500, and done a very similar role, as you'll see in a moment. Learned a tremendous amount from success and from failure, and I'm currently the CIO of Specsavers, which is one of our most successful adverts you'll see there. For me, the IT industry has been an interesting place to work, an interesting place to do business. One of the bigger challenges in the IT industry, of course, is that everybody needs technology, but how it can be exploited and how it can be led becomes very important. And certainly when I joined the government as a CIO at Transport for London, which is a transport authority here in London, and then as the CIO for HMRC, which is one of the biggest collectors of taxes in the world, what was interesting was I actually was actually named as I joined there as the most prehistoric CIO to join government, which I found hugely hilarious. So the Daily Mail chased me then for 2 years, living in my front garden for most of it, and you'll see some of those experiences in a moment. But learning about how to become a successful CIO, there's no tuition, there's no book, there's no handset. It is actually about learning from experiences. And I'm going to give you some of my views and some of my thoughts as we go through those. Of course, if you are a successful CIO, you have to learn from that success. There's a very famous quote from a guy called Harry Banks, who wrote a project management book that said this: if your project succeeds first time, try to hide your astonishment. And I certainly think sometimes, as a CIO, when things work first time, it may be somewhat shocking. The more interesting one is probably from a consultancy I was once a part of, a very famous one of the big four, under the chapter entitled, If Your Project Technology Project Fails. The first paragraph says this: if your technology project fails, either destroy all evidence that you tried or redefine with the customer what success stands for. And leadership in IT is about understanding, redefining, and getting that knowledge as we go on. For me, it is about understanding that drive, that dynamic in becoming a successful CIO. So let me start with some definitions, because I believe that definitions are very important to get right. And by definitions, I guess what I'm trying to describe is what is the style to which I believe I and other successful CIOs operate. And why I start with the style of definition is this: if you understand that basis, you can understand everything else that is being said. It doesn't mean you have to agree with it, but at least you can understand it. And what to me is important about definitions is to get them right. Now, I know the UK is going through a bit of a Brexit experience, you could say. What is interesting is the European Union on the 1st of January reissued its definitions of foodstuffs. Great timing, I thought. And they said this: snails are now defined as fish, in brackets, land-based. And I think the challenge is that we have to work out quite where we stand. So let's look at the first three of these, because they kind of fit together. Technology is now at the heart of everything. It's interesting when you come to Specsavers, a hugely successful medical retail store experience, as it is for any other retailer in particular or high consumer moving goods. You know, 5 years ago, a couple of dial-up lines into the store was sufficient. Now, with the amount of stuff we have to do in store, it has to be the fattest broadband you can do. And our partners and our managers begin to realize, as they are in all organizations, technology is now at the heart of everything we do. Saying it is easy. Styling it, leading it, is difficult and different. We have to make sure what we do is very customer and colleague centric. We spend a lot of time worrying about the customer and worrying about the customer journey, particularly around technology. But a good CIO recognizes it actually starts with the colleague, particularly a customer-facing colleague. Now, why do I say that? I've been in many organizations and many retail outlets, many places where customers are being faced by colleagues, and you can hear the colleagues speaking with real authority, perhaps about the product or the experience on the telephone or face-to-face. And then they get to use a bit of IT they don't trust. And you can hear their body language and their actual language itself begin to change. So style has to be, or philosophy has to be about customer-centric, colleague-centric design. And of course, those three put together end up with the words fit for purpose. It has to be designed for what it's meant to do if you're going to be a successful CIO. Because of my travel a few years ago, I was able to enjoy a certain class of travel on a well-known airline, which I won't mention. But this airline, as I went into the sort of the airway onto the front of the aircraft, a lady with Google glasses greeted me by my name. She recognized me from the photo that was appearing inside the technology of the glasses. And my definition of what I wanted to make me a good traveler in terms of my opening drink right through, she was able to recount this as I entered the area, which she then directed my seat. Very impressed. In fact, I sent a text to one of my friends in the company and said, do you know what? They are really using this stuff well. This is fit for purpose. It would have been helpful arriving in New York, of course, if my luggage had not arrived in Dusseldorf at that point. And although she had probably got that bit right, the airline had forgotten what their real fit for purpose was. But I'm sure Virgin has learned from that. The fourth thing, of course, is about the team. The philosophy of leadership is about getting the right team in the right place for the right purpose. I find many CIOs around me appoint teams that last for years. Most of us now begin to realize our teams last for a moment, and that moment may be a month, it may be a quarter, it may be a year, but that is the team to which you can deliver the dynamic revolution that your organization or enterprise really needs. In terms of style and philosophy, it's what is my style, or if you're going to be a leader, your style is important. I could read off 20 or 30 things here, but my overall philosophy and style to be a good technology leader is this. It's called split the room. When I went to work in the civil service, I used to sort of quip, and I was, you know, HMRC is a director general, so a very senior person, millions of civil servants. I used to say this, as a director general, allegedly, I'm very powerful. I could have announced that tomorrow, every single servant working for me, and there were thousands, would wear a green pair of socks. And the following would happen. A chunk would wear a green pair of socks, highly compliant workforce. A chunk would wear anything but green socks because they just want to let people know that they are civil servants and independent of thought. And a chunk in the middle would wear one green and one other color in case they had misheard. And what is important to recognize, as a leader, your job is to split the room. I can deal with 40% of people who hate me as a leader and 40% of people who love me as a leader. It's the bit in the middle that frightens me. More than 10%, then you will not be successful. And by splitting the room, a style thing is around role modeling, demonstrating, showing, understanding, recognizing. That then gives you the ability to earn the right. And my style of leadership to be a successful CIO, I believe, comes down to earning the right. When I joined HMRC, I'd been there about 2 months, and I worked for, I guess we would call them the CEO, but here they're called in the UK, perm secretaries, permanent secretaries. And I worked for a lady called Leslie Strathy, a beautiful and a wonderful woman to work for. And I'd been there a couple of months, and I went in with my standard five-slide show I'd used in the previous 15 enterprises and have used since. Slide number one described how bad the technology was. Slide number two described how bad it was going to get. Slide 3 set out, I guess, the hope for the future, the journey. Slide 4 described what it would then be like in a set period. You could 2020 or 2015, whatever horizon you wanted to do. And the last slide, if you got to it, was the money. My 5/6 slide presentation. And Leslie sat there, and my first slide described how bad things were in HMRC. When you're collecting £500 billion worth of taxes and paying out over £20 billion in childcare, believe you me, the IT was complex. The most modern system was in the early 80s, and by now it's 2013-14. The second slide described 10 years how bad it was going to be. And I could see a tear forming in her eye. It was that bad. And as a good salesman, I've never been a salesman, not like my AppDynamics colleagues, but as a good salesman, I sensed I was getting buy-in, whatever the technical sales phrase is. So I went for my third slide, and as I turned the page, Leslie, a very professional lady, said, "Phil, just stop. I've pre-read this. I know it. This is a fantastic synthesis of how bad it is and how bad it's going to be." And I get it. Before we come to the answer slide, can I just share with you? The printer in my office has not worked now for 9 weeks. When it's worked for 9 weeks, you pop back in and we'll pick up slide 3. And in 9 weeks' time, she very kindly invited me back. It's very formal civil service. She said, "You go ahead with slide 3 now." Well, she didn't know because I had one single server attached to her printer, 24/7 cover, and everything else going on. And it became a very famous story in HMRC because the strategy we embarked on, which I'm still delivering, going from 4% online to 92% online in 2 years, the most online tax authority in the world. You don't look too impressed by that. That was 2 years of my life. On the world was based on one strategy that got the internal nickname, the printer strategy. Because you have to earn the right to lead. Last two. The style of leadership, as a CIO, if you're going to be successful, always follow delivery, never follow fashion. I cannot tell you how many people come and sell me the thing that's going to save my world, that's going to feed the hungry, that's going to solve all the known conflicts in the world. My business wants to know, does that app stand up tomorrow for the whole day, if you don't mind, we're trying to flog something. And last but not least, courage and passion. And I guess I'll come back to that in a little bit more detail, but courage and passion are very important things for us to get right and understand. So that's about style. Well, let me talk to you a little bit about, I believe, that some of the challenges we are facing in the technology world today. These challenges, I believe, is what leadership needs to contend with if it's going to be successful. The first one may be a bit contentious, maybe, working in the IT industry, but I believe the IT department or team or division or whatever is absolutely fundamentally dead and has been for 10 years. It's just they don't know it yet. They're still the walking dead. You see, IT and CIOs like me have been banging around for 30 years saying technology is ubiquitous. It's commoditized. You can buy it. And the business in the end have believed it and gone and bought it, just not via the IT team. And now we go around with hate T-shirts, hating shadow IT and local people, something I'll come back to in a moment. I think, secondly, that shadow IT is now so normal, it's just growing. I believe, actually, the whole CIO, CDO, Chief Digital Officer debates, which I've called here the digital magpie, has become really serious. Can I tell you, and I say this all the time, talking to huge audiences around the world as I talk to other fellow CIO and IT leaders, I say this to you, if your division, your company, has just appointed a chief digital officer, resign immediately because they don't like you. It gets me a really abusive email, really offensive stuff. Then 3 months later, they write to me, "You're right, they let me go." Because the business realized the IT bloke or woman was going on about how bad and how hard and how difficult those legacy engines were. They go, "Right, digital is sexy and new and fast. Let's find a new one to do that and leave the other person to do that old stuff. And we've got what we asked for." And ultimately, I believe the IT department is dead because we have not recognized a key thing happening in the business, which is the level of automation. An automation at any and every level. which means ultimately IT is no longer at the heart of a business's thinking. And that IT now sits on the side. It's a huge challenge we face as we try and shout in and call in, try and fish into the bigger pond, but almost are bypassed in that conversation. Interesting enough, the fashion of technology versus the business process is becoming a huge challenge for us. Let me illustrate this in another way. I went out once with a back to HMRC again, it's a good illustration. I went out once with a VAT inspector. Value-added tax, sales tax, if you were, if you're not from another country. There's a huge issue in this country. And I went out with a very small, diminutive lady as a VAT inspector. She didn't know who I was, really. I was just on my orientation. And we went to meet her in the south of London, Southwark. And we got all our stuff together, and she briefed me on what I was going to go and do. We're going to go and see an Italian import-export company. Looking for about 25,000 of refunds they'd done, and she was going to investigate it. And I was going to go with her. And she briefed me on the system she was using to get the data and how the conversation was going to go. And, you know, she showed me a panic button. That's always, I found, a very positive pre-brief, the panic button, and all that sort of stuff. Just before we go, she reached into the drawer of her desk, a metal filing desk, and she pulled out her laptop. I thought, that's the incoming CIO. This is impressive. I'm going to see the laptop in action here. And she put the bag on the table, and she pulled the laptop out of the bag and put the laptop back in the drawer and locked it. I said, sorry, I don't mean to be rude, but the laptop's useless. It's so slow, I can't get a connection, the applications are so poor, but the bag is phenomenal. It's double zipped, so I can put private papers inside, it's got lots of pockets and my calculator and my pens and everything else. When I sat down with the IT team, which I met a few weeks after I joined, after my orientation, I said, how do you think it's going? He said, do you know what? We really have got it right with the business. So I recounted my VAT, VAT lady, laptop experience. So I said, so how come she has not really got the business process re-engineering around what she needs? It is not fit for purpose. Well, you see, we just banged out as many laptops as we could buy. We were following the fashion of laptops. As we rush to the cloud or anything else new, and by the way, none of it is new, it's just renamed by Gartner and by reselling companies just so they can sell more. Ultimately, what we're rushing towards is a destiny we don't understand. Cloud is more expensive than non-cloud. Let me tell you, I'm a buyer. I go totally on the cloud in Specsavers by the end of 2018. It's more expensive unless you buy the attributes to manage it around it, from cloud application management right through to the things we're talking about here today. That's gone quiet. Another challenge that we face is big is best. I loved working in local government, Transport for London. All we did was show off by the size of our projects. I'm working on a £100 million program. Who says someone? I'm working on a £1 billion program. Well, I was working on congestion charge. That killed them all. But ultimately, everybody was measuring their yardstick by their size. And you know what? Even people like me who spend their life forcing dramatic revolutionary change through organizations, particularly in technology, modular and small is still the most successful method. Big is not best. And of course, what we've realized in the last few years, it is not about the technology anymore. It is about the people change. In Aviva, we decided to do something very classic in the back office. We combined all our back office sort of machinery, photocopier, printer, fax machine, and on this one, we also put a document shredder. And we went from 10 devices a floor in 264 countries, you know, down to one device a floor to make people walk. Because they walk, they probably won't print. Does that make sense? You get the logic? And we put a queuing system on. You didn't get your print. All that good environmental stuff. And I sat on the help desk. The first time I went live was on Friday morning. And I sat on the help desk, listened to the calls, as a good leader would. How's it going? Oh, they love it. People are using it, got a few, except for this horrendous recorded call from Norway, where an English-speaking consultant had tried to fax his time sheet, had to do before 5 o'clock to get paid over the weekend as a weekly consultant. He faxed his time sheet in the section marked fax, except, of course, someone had moved it around, and in fact, it was a shredder. And the issue was, he wasn't going to get paid. people change is now bigger than technology change. I fall about laughing and then burst into tears when I meet CIOs who are spending more money on technology than they are on the arrival of the technology. They have missed the budgeting point. See, if you're not spending 30 or 40% on any IT project budget, you're facing a huge technology industry challenge. Your change will not land well. I mentioned before, automation, then we have commodity and shadow IT. And the last two, cybersecurity is always an issue. Not as big as some people say, but it's an important thing to understand as the people who are attacking all of our industries are learning and moving very quickly. I'll come back to that. And last but not least, my favorite current topic, I've just come from abroad, the big data lie. Now this one makes me smile. IBM came to see me, I'm not allowed to name any company. So IBM came to see me a little while ago. What's the worst they're gonna do? They came to see me about 2 years ago and said, Phil, big data is a thing of the future. I said, well, you're supposing that some of us have not noticed that data's been around for a bit of time. Ah, but nobody's really understood it. Nobody's really exploited it. We've got these computer systems, this huge supercomputer called, and it's good what they do and Watson and all that sort of stuff. It's a lie. Not that Watson's a lie, don't get me wrong, or IBM, or anybody else, but the big data thing's a lie. So we ran for the last 100 years with no data, right? No, you tell me. Because supposedly the suppliers have discovered data, how cool is that? Sales were looking light for the last couple of years. Thank God we found big data. You realize that digital and big data are the millennium bug of 2017, 18, and 19, don't you? If you've worked in the IT industry as long as I have, before they even invented computers, I started, what is interesting is that, of course, the millennium bug was the godsend for all CIOs on the supply side. Remember that? I could go into a board meeting, in 1999, and say, if we don't fund this change, this is probably subject to the millennium bug, and we'll stop. All known governance was suspended for approvals that year. We ran out of those ideas, but then came digital and big data. Thank God for that, because what else would companies buy? What else would a chief executive in his executive jet reading land and ring and say, do you know what, Phil, have we done big data yet? Are we digital? There's no such thing. Timely record keeping, understanding of customer records, joining them up, recognizing who owns them, who secures them, who transports them, who presents them, who exploits them, has been at the heart of most businesses for a long time. Automation and distribution, of course, we want more of that, but ultimately it is what the CIOs have always done and need to relearn. I believe it's important to recognize how we can reposition IT in any enterprise. And I'll go through these very quickly because I want to get on to, in my last few moments, two very important areas. So getting board ownership is critical. If you're going to be a successful CIO, the board have to believe in you. Most CIOs can describe describe what it's like. Most CIOs can describe what it's going to be like. Very few survive the journey in between. Does that make sense? It's bumpy. It's painful. Here in Specsavers, we are halfway through our bumpy journey. And I'm leaving in 2 months' time. Because I've done my job. I've created the revolution. And now we are giving it to an individual who's much more used to executing, sticking it, making it work, and seeing it through to the end. That's the trick of leadership. Knowing what you're good at, having board ownership, and then managing through the bumpiness of the journey. It's a challenge. We have to gain permissions. Board ownership, give submissions. If you're a leader in IT and don't use proof of concepts, you know, single 25, 30, 45,000 sterling type solution innovations, you're mad. You have to recognize permissions that come from that. For your own team, you have to actually get rallying points, positive and negative rallying points that allow you to drive a completely different conversation. You have to set the vision and the journey. Make sure you're creating dissatisfaction to actually where people are right now. People recognize that. Your own team begin to recognize that. A dissatisfaction with where they are right now. as a leader repositioning in IT, you have to actually carry out iconic change. Something perhaps small but personable, something quite dramatic, something that really gets people's attention. I remember when I arrived at an organization called Centrica, log-on times were a bit of a lottery. Does that make sense? And I got a bit of a hate mail, which I'll come back to over this. So I sat down and I said, I wanted something really iconic. In the first few months, we've got a huge amount to do, but something really dramatic that everybody gets. And the IT team looked at me and went, well, we get them a new laptop. No, you're missing the point. What some back office, you know, they all thought I was there for the customer, which ultimately I was, but some back office thing that really gets everybody's head saying, wow, this is different. Log-on times was seen to be the right answer. And it was a lottery. Your log-on time could be a few minutes, seconds rather, a few minutes. There was one position, one building where the net was so bad, about 25 minutes. I'll come back to that building. So we worked flat out for 3 months on log-on times. Seems amazing now, doesn't it, all these years later? Log-on times. And we ground it down second by second, minute by minute. And log-on times, 98% when I left of log-on times, were sub 20 seconds, which I thought was quite impressive personally. You don't look too impressed by that, tough crowd, but anyway, not too bad. Some of you should try it. Except for one lady who wrote to me saying, you are the worst CIO, I was actually called IT Transformation Director, you're the worst IT Transformation Director we have ever had. Now, I love never split the room. I've got no problem with that. She said, I used to come in, and she was in this 25-minute building, I used to come in, log on, get my breakfast downstairs in the canteen, come back, and I was on. Now, of course, it's 20 seconds. My boss won't let me go and get the breakfast. I've got to do it in my own time. Iconic change repositions IT. User-centric design repositions IT. Making the enterprise recognize that you are central to the business and to its needs is critical. Past and future ownership of the technology broker role demonstrates particularly what we're trying to do in terms of partnering. The IT department is no longer dead because ultimately we've repositioned, or if we haven't, we should be repositioning ourselves as the broker, as the honest partner, as the assisted journey through the complex IT world in which we operate. And that is so important. Now, just because I suspect many of you are from suppliers as much as you might be from leaders, let me just say, from me also, to be a successful leader, we need a good, strong, and competent supply side. Now, I do like the whole supply side thing, you know. The size of the challenge is always immense. You might be aware of this story. Let me tell you this story just to make you think about consultancies and professional services. There was a very famous story told of a shepherd who was looking after his sheep on a hillside, a classic picture, if you will. And suddenly along this deserted road came a bright, new, shiny Porsche. Screeched to a halt, and a driver, a very young man, dressed in an Armani suit with shades. He got out there with his Tag Heuer watch, and he had his posh shoes and everything else. He got out and he said to him, shepherd man, and the shepherd came over. He says, look, if I can guess accurately exactly how many sheep you have, can I have one? And the shepherd went, that's impressive. If you can guess how many sheep I have, gladly I will give you a sheep. And that young man, he got out his laptop and his GPS and his positioning as a software, and he's doing this thing, and he came back and he printed off his little mini printer, little dots all over this sort of geographical thing where all the sheep were, and he said, I've worked it out. You have 1,586 sheep. The shepherd was astounded. You are absolutely right. Any sheep you want, any of those 1,586, you pick one, you can have it. And the young man packed away his equipment, put everything in his boot, put the sheep in his boot and everything else, and went to drive away. And one moment. Shepherd said, I bet you're a professional services management consultant, right? And the young man goes, I am. I mean, how can you tell? I've got no badge. I'm not wearing any company ID. I've got no pass. As well, says she, I can tell you. First of all, you came here without being invited. Secondly, you charged me a fee for something I already knew. And thirdly, you clearly don't understand anything about my business. Now, can I have my dog back? And I think the challenge I think the challenge that we face as supply side is that we need to recognize that we need to be as professional as everybody else. You need to learn as suppliers, with us as customers, to partner with risk. Not what it says on the slide, genuine risk. Stuff that's gonna cost you money, credibility, brand value. That's risk. Not, I've lent you one of my girls or guys who's minus 13 years of age and this is their first role, I'm working at risk. No, you are not. You're entertaining your junior people. You've got to learn a supply side to make me successful as a CIO to stop selling me fashion. You need to learn to sell me what I think is very important, the subject matter expertise. And that subject matter expertise is critical. The day of the generalist, the general SI is largely dead. We want people to say, I'm good at everything, but I'm absolutely amazing at this. And my fear about AppDynamics, other organizations, as they're acquired by others, they need to fiercely hold on to what they're good at and what they stand for, because the day of the generalist is dead. And that's what the buy side says. Commercially, our partners to make successful CIOs, our partners to grow up commercially. Do us deals that are recognizing where we are. I was explaining earlier, our current version of AppDynamics doesn't sit with us. It sits with a third party, and we're not really willing to have it. You try and find a license deal that does that. Find deals that work where our business is, where it scratches where we are itching as leaders. And then we've got to help us find the technology leaders of tomorrow. All those people working for you need to come and work for me. Then they can come back and work for you. Does that make sense? Because you make them better people. And in the meantime, you're half-training them on some of the questions I have. We have so little innovation and move between supply side and buy side. Very poor. Innovation and invention, of course, is important. Understand what the daily performance is all about. I love it when suppliers come up and say, we have something that's going to, I mean, we've just done a huge deal. Is it revealed? Oh, it doesn't matter. Anyway, we've done a huge deal with Fujitsu recently for supporting our retail enterprises in the UK, shops, that's by the way in English, in the UK and Northern Europe. And I said to Fujitsu, you're the best price. You're the biggest company to do it. We love you. We love this presentation, this bid. The problem is, you're currently serving us in this small space, and you're appalling. Ah, they said, it's a different Fujitsu. A different Fujitsu? How cool is that? How do you spell, I'll write it down, how do you spell the different Fujitsu? Is the capital F missing? Is it got next to you? Of course, fortunately, they saw the funny side of it because I've been working with them for 30 years, but we have to get into a position where every supplier can help a CIO be successful. You'll realize why in a moment. To be the best, we've got to have partners who understand our daily performance and capability. Last two, be part of and not fight the technology team. It is a fundamental error when supply side meets the business side and the broker isn't there. Not because I'm an advocate for the broker, but something is missing, and those parties will fall out without a good broker, and there it will be a problem. And last but not least, the supply side have to learn to partner. Good grief, I just spend my time being the SI in inverted commas, which I shouldn't have to be, in between suppliers, which I find quite depressing. So my last slide, how, why, where, successful IT. Well, ultimately, it is this. Leadership as a CIO or an IT leader is everything. And for this, we have to understand what drives that statement. I stand up in front of many CIOs and trainee CIOs and explain to them that the role of the CIO on a board or any leadership team, particularly on a board, is probably the most lonely job you'll ever have. It's not a great advocate, by the way, great advert. Marketing director, sales, everybody loves those, as long as they've got great adverts like we have, should have gone to, or you've got great sales numbers, right? Love or hate, that's easy. Operations director, pretty tough job, but everybody wants you to be successful because you're managing the interface. The product director or product directors, you know, inventing and finding new stuff and combining and pricing and differentials, you love them, right? Logistics, weirdos, but anyway, gently logistics and supply chain, you know, that's all a bit weird, but they're good people, solid, salt of the earth, manufacturer, supplier, so you get those. Oh, and then the CIO bloke woman, whose first two words are no, and it's too expensive. Now, what's your question again? But in all seriousness, leadership of IT is key. It is one of the loneliest jobs. My day is marked by the size of the fire, not if I have a fire. Does that make sense? And if you come into the industry, you think, there'll be a day it all works. I've got some really bad news for you. There isn't. Then you have to be courageous as a leader in IT to be successful. Courage, decisive. The story is told of a kindergarten teacher who asked her children to draw any picture they wanted in their free time. And this three-year-old little girl was drawing a picture, and the kindergarten teacher said, "What are you drawing?" She said, "I'm drawing a picture of God." And the kindergarten teacher said, "But no one's ever seen God." And the little girl said, "Well, they will in a minute." And that level of courage that she had in drawing that picture is a level of courage you should have stepping as a leader in IT into the unknown. Passion, pride, culture changer. I worked in Cadbury for a while, and on my first few days, I was very kind to be taken by, as part of an orientation, based in Bourneville in Birmingham, where the main Cadbury factory is, or was, sorry, where they used to manufacture and make through the bars. And so I went there, I've been there on Wednesday, very important day of the week. This very senior board member looking after me, a member of the family, took me out to the car park. I thought it was a bit of a strange start to the day. And he was in this vast car park in Bourneville. And he stood there and said, "Right, stand there." So I stood there. I wondered if I was going to get chopped within 3 days of being there. And he said, "Take a deep breath." So I took a deep breath. He said, no, use your nose, sniff. So he said, "Right." And again. So I did it again, somewhat a bit weird now, wondering quite what was happening. And he said, "That is our culture." So I looked around. There must be a clue in the car park. Some very big cars. Sniff again. "That's our culture. What can you smell?" "Well, it's Wednesday," he said. "You can smell the cooking of the cocoa beans," which happens every Wednesday in Cadbury, before they're bought by an American company, but leave that to one side. "That's our culture. Every time you think you're doing something else, come out on a Wednesday to this car park like I do, sniff, that's our culture." IT leadership is about creating a cultural change that will never, ever allow an enterprise to go back. Be human. Connect with revolutionaries. Leave people feeling big. And my last two, which I guess I personally find very encouraging. Always think the unthinkable. Someone said to me in an interview recently, as part of my, leaving a Specsavers, someone said, "What would you say is your main raison d'etre? What's your main driver? What drives you to lead what is a relatively straightforward and comfortable job now? You've done all the heavy lifting." It won't be that comfortable, by the way. We've still a lot to do. "But what drives you to that and the previous job and the previous, what is it?" I said, "I love the word no. I run towards the word no. To be a successful CIO, you have to recognize that you have to deliver the impossible. Change is messy. Leadership is lonely. But we need to be, and I need to be, you need to be the IT leader or the CIO that actually your enterprise needs right now if you're going to be deemed to be successful. Make sure you connect where people are." There's a phrase stuck up in my office or my office space area. It says this: "I will forget what you said. In time, I will forget what you did. But I will never forget how you made me feel." How does your enterprise feel about you, your IT, your division? When I worked for Transport for London, I used to get off the underground using an Oyster card and arrive at a set of traffic lights and look up, having used two pieces of my technology, and be full of pride. Being a CIO, a successful CIO, is simply the most challenging and role I've ever seen or ever known. But with success, it is also a huge honor to deliver. Ultimately, you're leading companies, individuals, and teams from a place of certainty, even if they're complaining, to a place of potential certainty. It's a huge leap of faith, and it needs a successful leader that actually can take them on that journey so they arrive on the other side successfully. Successful leadership, being in IT, is about being a successful CIO. Thank you.
That was fantastic. So I've got a couple of friendly helpers at either side of the room with microphones. So questions, anyone? If you just put your hand and we can get a microphone to you. No? Any questions? I'll kick it off. One of the things a lot of our customers tell us, Phil, is great, you've got this shiny technology, it helps me, it shows me all these beautiful maps and, you know, makes people work better. But how do I break down the organizational silos between these teams that seemingly hate each other and don't want to talk to each other? What's been your experiences dealing with that challenge?
Yeah, and I think there's a number of ways of dealing with it, of course, and people think that technology only is the answer. And there is some technology stuff that answers it. But most silos are broken physically. You know, I inherited a building in Specsavers where there's lots of different teams working in the same building. So all we did was I just invented it one night. I don't know quite where it came from. Collaboration by collision. I made up this phrase and came in next day and mentioned it. Went, what's that? I said, I don't know. Give me a second. And so what I do is I removed all the things that made it convenient for people to operate in the building. So we had a coffee point, four or five different coffee points on the floor. We had one. So people had to queue to get their coffee and elbow and find a cup and everything else because they had to collaborate and talk while they're in the same place. Does that make sense?
Yep.
We had, as I told you before, these printers, loads of printing areas. We just got it down to one, so people had to queue and find. So we deliberately make people collide. And you can do that physically or metaphysically. People just naturally get on. So we tried to create space. I went to one company recently, and they have just introduced an app. It's part of the Google apps. It's not, they wrote it, but it's based on the Google sort of diary. And what's interesting is, if you, every Wednesday, you register in the morning, it looks past your last 3 months' diary and says, Phil has never met Ian. There's nothing in his diary. And he sends an invite for half an hour at 12 o'clock between me, Phil and Ian to meet in the soft play area. And I walk and I go, hi, he goes, hi. But eventually it breaks out. They're just trying to find ways to collaborate all the time. But it is by humans colliding. Right. You have to create as much, both online, physically, and metaphysically as well. Right. Very hard.
Thank you. Any other questions? Down the back there.
What's your view on generic office politics, because sometimes it can hamper the development that a team may achieve without it being present there. So how do you deal with it? What are your views on it? It is a necessity. It exists everywhere. But how do you tackle a disruptive politics equation in an office?
Yeah, so it depends what is motivated. I mean, people to pretend there's no office politics at any level, from board level right down to day-to-day office, are being foolish. There is office politics. But it's how you exploit it for where you are. I mean, you know, if I just use my recent example, most organizations have a marketing department that's trying to do digital web and e-commerce, and IT is trying to do IT, so I'll go at the mega level if that helps. Now, it could have been quite an issue, so I just sat down with a marketing guy and said, look, you're going to recruit a chief marketing, digital marketing officer, I'm going to recruit a chief digital IT person, shall we just recruit each other's? He went, how cool is that? So he recruited the lady that works for me on digital. I recruited the man. We obviously got involved with each other, didn't do completely blind. But ultimately, we actually recommended to each other our recruiters to spend all their time working together. So it could have been a huge area of conflict, but we recognized it and decided to exploit it. And then people started saying to us, what do you think? Marketing's got shadow IT. We go, we love it. Because, of course, we're all over their IT. But we haven't brought it inside our area, but they've allowed it to be open. So it's not fighting it, it's working with it all the time. It's really hard to avoid. You'll see on this slide, I had a small orange thing that said this, do it as promised, consistently with passion. That's the vision statement of the IT team in Specsavers. When we put that around the company, people rang up and said, right, we'll find out if they can. Office politics. So we did. They went, bugger, they are quite passionate. And it is quite done as promised and so on. It is playing it and using it positively. Every now and then, of course, you have to call it out, but that's a different issue. There's a question over here, I think.
question.
Phil, so I'm guessing your first job probably wasn't as a CIO of a multinational corporation. What experience do you think put you in a good place to be a good leader? And do you think it's more a technical background or a managerial background, or can you know too much detail?
Yeah. So let me answer it at the end. These days, and if you read my CV and so on, it says I'm a business leader who happens to have done IT. I could have been good at organizing toilet cleaning. Seriously, I'm a good organizer. I'm quite passionate, you might not have noticed, and I'm quite dynamic around so any subject, to a degree I could have done, I chose IT. For me personally, I'm so old, I joined the post office telecommunications, which for you youngsters is now called BT. And I joined as a debt collector, collecting money in central London. They like me, I'm very short, I'm very wimpy with glasses. They didn't think anybody would hit me or hurt me, so I collected debts. And no joke, that's actually what they said in the interview. And I wrote a paper after being there a year, based in central London. I wrote a paper because I was arriving with the final bill for payment about a year after they'd left. And I wrote an angry debt collector letter to some higher-ups in BT saying the billing system is rubbish. And at that point, BT was being formed, they were separating, and by sheer accident, I became the billing manager for the West End District, and then the billing director for the UK. And then eventually I realized it wasn't the bills, it was the IT on which it sat. And I've done the same job ever since. Quite a boring way into it. I have no qualifications whatsoever. If that encourages you, nothing. No. I have an O-level, that's about it, seriously.
So I think we're on quite tight time, we're going to turn around, but I'm please put your hands together, a huge round of applause for Phil.